In a moment, we've got a gentleman called Gordon Bowden who's going to speak. This is Gordon here. If you give him a big hand. Okay, Gordon's going to speak, and then I'll give you a quick update of what we're doing. So I think, Gordon, would you like to say a few words? Thank you very much, sir.
Thanks, Mitch, for inviting me on this platform. Thanks a lot. And thank you all for giving up your time to come here. I hope I can give you a little bit of an insight into the darker side of the City of London. Something that you won't hear about in the normal press, but as an ex-serviceman, it turns my stomach, and any police officer here would have no understanding of what organised crime is linked to political parties. Trust me, I hope in 15 minutes I can persuade you to use your fingers on the internet and search certain addresses. Because of the way that the justice system works, very few people will understand that when you make accusations against individuals or companies, you then deny your right in the justice system, because then that gets taken away as used as forensic fact or evidence in a prosecution case. So all I'm trying to give you in 15 minutes is a short side of 15 years of my life in uncovering the darker side of the City of London and the people that work within it that are stealing billions. Not millions, they are stealing billions of pounds, and they're running from multiple boilerrooms, not in Burkina Faso or Nigeria.
All the evidence is here.
South Africa.
This is me interviewing Gordon.
Oh, brilliant.
We have enough forensic evidence to bring the whole British establishment down. All the paedophiles, all the thieves, all the money launderers.
So first of all,
he has 13 years of forensic documents.
My partner, retired partner, lost her life savings in an investment capital venture.
This is where it stops.
Yeah. Over 4 years, I assisted two attorneys of law who did and conducted the money trail back to the City of London and various addresses in Finchley Road. Those addresses were 788 790 Finchley Road, and those addresses were interlocked to the money laundering mechanisms, including $130 million. The controlling directors of those companies that operate out of those addresses are Mary Philomena Stephen, David Perlman, Barbara Cahan, and many other of the Cahan family who were the administrators of those addresses. Now, I know you're all intelligent people. You have an opportunity to contradict what I'm telling you today. Look at those addresses. Look how many companies operate out of those addresses, and look at the physical state of those addresses. Those addresses, 788 790 Finchley Road, 923 Finchley Road, 665 Finchley Road, 420 Finchley Road, are all interconnected networks that control over 2 million shell companies. Those shell companies are linked to the arms trade. Now, I need not tell you about the arms trade with Iraq and Iran, and I'm an ex-serviceman, and that's where my disgust comes from, finding out some of the physical facts. They are forensic facts. They're not hearsay, they're not conspiracy, they are facts. The people that operate those boiler rooms have been working with people like Mohammed Adnan Khashoggi and various arms companies in this country, including BAE Systems. And so, my first start and my first journey into this, my crusade, started with a basic fraud, which led me, as an engineering officer in the Royal Air Force, to understand the mechanics of organized crime and boiler rooms. Those boiler rooms are moving money in international boiler rooms to Australia, Canada, Germany, Cyprus. They're all interlocked, and they're all controlled by very senior members of the House of Lords. Don't deny that. You can have a look. Just check those addresses. Look at all the companies. In one particular company, under Company Directors Limited and Temple Secretaries, you will find that they control over 460,000 companies. That's four people controlling over 500,000 shell companies. Ask yourself, where is the money for our health services? Where are the money for the police? Where are the money for the fire department? Where's it gone? They're cutting down on the police forces. These are the people that protect our country. The National Health Services, it's going to be privatized. people like Sir Malcolm Rifkin, if you check and know how to check corporate documents, what you will find is that Sir Malcolm Rifkin is a co-director with Sir John Chilcott. Now, I don't have to tell you about the Chilcott report. 5 years to produce a report. So, ask yourselves this. The City of London, the capital, the financial capital of the world, protects a very, very important syndicate of very high-ranking people, and they are politicians, members of the House of Lords. If you check the directorship lists of those companies, oil, gas, and mining companies, you will find what I found 10 years ago. It's vile, billion-pound organized crime, fraud, theft, and money laundering. This is nothing to do with genuine companies. I have been an expert at dismantling corporate oil, gas, and mining companies that are shell companies. That means that they're director-only companies that operate on the alternative investment market. The alternative investment market is a casino. It's a casino for organized crime, fraud, theft, money laundering, and insider trading. And if you know anything about the stock exchange and the penny stock, if you check some of the companies that I've exposed, I will name them. I'm not ashamed to name them, and I'm not scared to be called by the directors of those companies to face them in a court of law. I exposed five companies that operate purportedly in the Falkland Islands. They are Desire Petroleum, Rock Hopper Resources, Falklands Oil and Gas, Argus Exploration. These are some of the companies, including Border and Southern Petroleum, that are virtual companies. That means that they are director-only cash shells that by law only have to have a website and an AIM Rule 26 admission document. And then, as small startup companies, they can raise millions. Between those five companies, they raised over £1 billion. It's all gone. They've stolen it. They've stolen it because they moved it to subsidiary companies structured in the British Virgin Islands, Panama, Cyprus. That money has been silted out of those companies, not just by ordinary directors. These directors are nothing more than con artists, and they take you people for idiots. It's there. All you have to know is the keys to open those doors, to look at those companies and understand how they can steal billions. Those are the companies that we should get the politicians to investigate. You're talking about those addresses that I mentioned in Finchley Road. Anybody can use the internet and ask why two companies, Red Star Enterprises and Minacorp, was structured out of that address by the directors of those company administrators, Company Directors Limited and Temple Secretaries. Those companies have been put under inquiry by the United States Senate for stealing $1.5 billion of the American defense budget. Why didn't our David Cameron, Tony Blair, Gordon Brown, why didn't any of those stand up and say, why aren't we investigating those companies? Why aren't we checking those addresses to find out why there's 500,000 shell companies that have no financial records, that tend to asset strip public listed companies, which are fake oil, gas, and mining companies? They're talking about us running out of oil. If you check the alternative investment market, you will find that there are over 1,300 fake oil, gas, and mining companies, all run by the same bunch of directors. Now, if you were to be £400 in debt every month, your bank would cut up your credit cards. How come these companies are allowed to raise billions? Billions, and there is no accountability. Why? Because those directors of those virtual oil, gas, and mining companies are the funders of political parties. And that's where you don't understand. I'm trying to give you little keys that you can check yourself. And I hope for your children, for your grandchildren, you will look there and make these people, politicians, accountable. The police, how many restrictions have they had in their sort of manpowering, where they're restricted to street patrols? Some of them haven't even got cars. Some of them resort to paper cutouts outside supermarkets. If that's what this country is all about, where our intelligence services are protecting this country, then there's something wrong. Look at the financials of organized crime, and somewhere in each of those companies you'll find a politician or a member of the House of Lords. It's knowing where to look, knowing where to dismantle them, and understanding the mechanics of organized crime. So, any questions? Anybody want to ask me a question about what other oil, gas and mining companies are taking the mick out of everybody? All the politicians.
This everybody knows Tony Blair was Siri Lund. It's when he was in charge of giving away all that money. When he left, built diamond mines and giving so much land. The young London mining company were booming.
Now you just mentioned Tony Blair. Part of my
Sierra Leone war, but he gave up millions and millions and millions. Freetown. I was there in February. I know about Tony Blair.
This gentleman just mentioned Tony Blair. Let me tell you something. Very few people would remember that Tony Blair was made an advisor of a company called UI Energy. UI Energy was operated by a bunch of South Korean con artists who then had oil drilling rights in northern Iraq. Nobody will understand the importance of that. Who were the other advisors for that UI Energy? Well, there was the ex-Australian Prime Minister, Bob Hawke. There was members of George Bush's military advisor team. They were all made advisors of a South Korean fixed-up corporate that had access to the oil rights in northern Iraq. And you're telling me that the Iraq wars weren't about oil? No, they weren't. I'll tell you a little secret that none of you know. None of you know. I've been in touch with a whistleblower, a very senior, well-respected, retired civil engineer. That gentleman is a man that I hold in high esteem as an engineer because of his honesty and his friendship with myself, and he put himself at risk, at great risk. That man, I'm not going to name him because he's under the Official Secrets Act, which I don't try to cross the line on. But that gentleman gave me inside information that in 1989, a certain young Conservative member, and that would be David Cameron, went to a place called Pelindaba. Now I know where Pelindaba is because I was a mining engineer for Goldfields of South Africa as well as an Air Force engineer. Pelindaba was the apartheid government's secret nuclear weapons experimental facility just outside Pretoria. In 1989, I am told, and I will repeat what I'm told, that David Cameron went with a guy called Sir Ken Warren and Dr. David Kelly. Do you know that name?
Yes.
Anybody know Dr.
Yes.
David Kelly?
Yeah.
And they went to Pelindaba to arrange, which was all pre-arranged, that before the 1994 general election and handover to the ANC government, 20 kiloton battlefield ready gravity drop nuclear weapons would be moved from Pelindaba and out of South Africa before the handover to the ANC. Now, because I was also security cleared to work with nuclear weapons, as in the WE-177s, I also know the destructive power of nuclear weapons. Those 9 weapons, 6 were sent to Chicago for decommissioning, and 3 were purchased by a section of Tory grandees. Those names, I have some of the names, not all of them. And it was an organized, orchestrated purchase where they were onward sold to the British government at extended price, which meant that these people were making millions in that purchase. I am told Dr. David Kelly went to Pelindaba. He organized the weapons cradles and the fitting into 20-foot ISO containers of the 9 weapons, and those 9 weapons were then railed to Durban Harbour. Dr. David Kelly would then hand over cash to the the sellers, which was Arms Corps of South Africa, and the dealer, in-between dealer, which was John Arnold Breeding Camp, an ex-Rhodesian arms trader. The other company involved in Britain was a company called Astra Holdings. Astra Holdings was run by an MI6 spoof called Stephanus Adolphus Cock, and he was implicated in various other misdealings with Midlands Bank as their weapons dealer and weapons procurement dealer for that bank. I am told that Dr. David Kelly was ordered using a UOR, which is an urgent operation requirement invoice, to purchase 3 cylinders from Arms Corps via Astra Holdings, which were then railed from Durban onto a ship, and Dr. David Kelly, apparently from my source, moved those weapons to Oman for the retake of Kuwait. Those weapons were then put in a storage facility, and they were used as a deterrent and a retaliatory weapon should Saddam use chemical or bio agents against our coalition and UK forces. As we know, no such weapons were used against us, and so those weapons remained in a storage facility until the cessation of hostilities. I am told by my source that Dr. David Kelly, at the cessation of hostilities, went back to organize the movement and onward shipping of those 3 20-kiloton nukes to Chicago for decommissioning. When he opened up the containers, they were missing. I am told by my source that those weapons found their way into Iraq and then onward into Syria. I am told this, I swear by Almighty God, that this is the information that's been given to me, where our politicians are accountable for those nuclear weapons that were lost. I'm further told that one of those weapons was detonated by North Korea on the 23rd of May 2009. Check the internet, it's there. So where was the money trail for these particular 3 purchased nukes? It's in Hansard. Have a look in Hansard. Hansard, June the 22nd, 1993, 17.8 million was deposited into the Conservative Party accounts by a person called John Arnold Breeding Camp under his tobacco company's front shell company. 17.8 million. And that was the kickback and the money trail for those 3 nuclear weapons. If you have a constituent MP, whether it be Labour, Conservative, Lib Dem or UKIP, you can ask them to contact me to contradict what I'm telling you now. Because, one, I have the forensic correspondence between myself and the Iraq Inquiry Secretary, and further, every single politician in this country. Because it's my duty. Anybody that loses a tactical, battlefield-ready, gravity-drop nuclear weapon needs to be put in front of a jury or in front of an inquiry to ascertain on what conditions were those weapons purchased and what conditions they were lost and where they went and how much they were sold to North Korea for. It's your future, everyone, your children, your grandchildren, to understand that in a few short months you will have a pen. It's the biggest weapon that you can have. But before you put a cross in a box or a tit, go and speak to your politician. Ask them if this is not fact. I see you're recording it and taping it. Brilliant. Do it. I have been put on various websites and interviewed on a few radio shows. Those radio shows are accessible to anybody. You can look for it. Just look up 788 790 Finchley Road. Just look at 3 lost nuclear weapons. Just look at Dr. David Kelly. You will find some of my research work. It's not hearsay. It's not conspiracy. I've dealt with these people. I've dealt with them. I know who they are. And I know the reach and the bottomless pockets that they have to protect them, because I've been threatened. They've bashed on my door late at night with giving me solicitor's letters to take my stuff off the internet. I won't, because it's my duty. And I will never fall back on that. Thank you.
Thank you, Gordon. Surely a very noble and brave man. Thank you, Gordon.